Hi, this is Dr. A with your medical terminology video on the digestive system. We're going to look at all the diagnostic procedures for the digestive system. So we're going to start with clinical laboratory test. We're going to look at a few tests. So we have alanine transaminase. So that's ALT. It is an enzyme that is normally present in the blood. Levels are increased in persons with liver disease. So this could be, you know, a hepatitis, for example, can cause an increase in ALT. Aspartate transaminase is AST, and it's an enzyme that is normally present in the blood, and the levels are increased in persons with liver disease also. So if AST increases, ALT increases. But now sometimes AST is also found in muscles, so sometimes if just the AST is increased and the ALT is normal, then it might end up being related to a muscular problem. A fecal occult blood test, or FOBT, is a lab test to determine whether a microscopic amount of blood are present in feces. It is also called a hemocult or a stool GWAC test. It has to do with the reagent that is used. And so this is good to detect like maybe chronic inflammation of the GI tract, especially the colon and intestines, in stool that looks normal but might contain trace amounts of blood. The H. pylori antibody test is a test to diagnose H. pylori infection that is associated with peptic ulcer disease. An ovine parasite is a stool sample that is collected and then examined to detect the presence of parasites or their eggs. Serum bilirubin is the test to determine the amount of bilirubin in the bloodstream. Elevated levels indicate liver disease, and elevated levels of bilirubin will cause jaundice also. Stool culture is a test of feces to look for the presence of the pathogenic bacteria. Now, if you think about it, stool contains a lot of bacteria. A lot of it is supposed to be there. But when we do a stool culture, we are looking specifically for pathogenic strains such as salmonella, for example. A tissue transglutaminase test, antibody test, or a TTG, is a blood test for celiac disease. It detects antibodies that are formed in the autoimmune response to gluten. If this test is positive, they have celiac. If it is negative, they could still have celiac and just not be reactive to that test. Diagnostic imaging, we're going to look at bite wing x-ray. It's an x-ray taken with part of the film holder positioned between and parallel to the teeth. They do that to get x-rays of the teeth and the bone around the teeth. A cholecystogram is an x-ray image of the gallbladder. Intravenous cholecystography is an x-ray of the gallbladder and the bile ducts after an intravenous injection of dye. The lower gastrointestinal series or lower GI series are x-ray images of the colon and rectum that are taken after the administration of a barium by enema. That is called a barium enema, and barium is a contrast dye. This is the type of picture that it will lead. And for example, it could reveal if you have diverticuli or pouches, for example, in the colon. Percutaneous transhepatic cholangiography, also known as PTC, is an x-ray of the liver and the bile ducts after the injection of contrast medium directly into the liver. An upper gastrointestinal or UGI series is an x-ray of the esophagus, stomach, and duodenum after an oral administration of a barium contrast material, which is something you swallow. It is also called a barium swallow study. And now let's go to some endoscopic procedures. So a colonoscope is an instrument that is used to view inside the colon. Colonoscopy is a process of visually examining the colon by passing a colonoscope through the anus and rectum and then up the sigmoid colon, etc., looking up the entire colon. Endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography, ERCP, is a procedure that is used to visualize the hepatic duct, the common bile duct, and the pancreatic duct. It involves the use of an endoscope, x-rays, and contrast dye. And esophagogastroduodenoscopy, or an EGD, is the use of a flexible fiber optic scope to visualize the esophagus, stomach, and the beginning of the duodenum. So you have to get it down, swallow it, get it down the esophagus, and this would be something you could use to see if a person has esophageal varices, or has stomach ulcers, or duodenal ulcers. So a gastroscope is an instrument used to view inside of the stomach. And gastroscopy is a procedure in which a flexible gastroscope is passed through the mouth down the esophagus to visualize inside the stomach. And that would permit viewing of the ulcers and peptic ulcer disease. A laparoscope is an instrument used to view inside the abdominal cavity. So when we talk about laparoscopic surgery, a lot of times we talk about doing a procedure with small incisions into the abdomen and using laparoscopes to go, for example, a gallbladder removal surgery could be done laparoscopically. So laparoscopy is a procedure in which a lighted laparoscope is passed through the abdominal wall and used to visually examine the abdominal cavity. And then you can, of course, use that also to facilitate surgery. A sigmoidoscope is an instrument used to view the inside of the sigmoid colon, which is the S part, which is like towards the end of the colon, right before the anus and rectum. And sigmoidoscopy is a procedure in which a flexible sigmoidoscope is used to visually examine the sigmoid colon. And that is the last pathology for the gastrointestinal system.